Thank you so much, Admiral Howe, for the gracious welcome. Thank you all for having me here. It's a real honor and privilege. I actually prepared carefully for this evening. And in the last hour or two, I've been reconsidering whether I should just say nothing at all and just begin a question section of anybody who might have things they might see differently from what I was presenting in the Atlantic in my article. But I thought, in the tradition of respect to the Navy and to the armed forces in general, my own dad was a Navy doctor. I spent about the first 5 years of my life in various Navy bases when he was traveling around during the early Korean War era. Out of respect for the higher educational institutions of the military, which I've been impressed with throughout my years as a correspondent, I'll tell you a story about that in a moment, and just as part of the spirit of fair play and in gratitude to the Naval War College Foundation and to the Tice family who are making this event possible, I thought I should do my part to give you an opening pitch. I'll try to say some things about the argument that I was presenting in the Atlantic that might not have been evident from the article itself, say some things that I've learned since in the months since that magazine has come out, and then try to augment it with ways in which I think the argument I'm making to a mainly civilian readership, what implications that might have for the military professionals from the United States and around the world who are represented here. So that's the plan of action, about which I'll tell you a little more in a while. First, I want to tell you the story of my initial exposure to military higher education. When I got back from graduate school in England in 1972, I got into the fledgling magazine business. I knew there were big bucks in political journalism, so I signed on with a magazine called the Washington Monthly. And whenever you're thinking about the economic sacrifices that go with military service, I'll tell you that the day after I signed on with the Washington Monthly, it declared Chapter 11 bankruptcy. And that was a very good conditioning for the glamorous life of a journalist that would follow. But the Atlantic is, the Washington Monthly is still going on. And a little while after that, I worked on my first freelance article for the Atlantic, which was back in 1974. And I was the introduction of a then radical concept that national security might involve things other than just nuclear bombs and correlation of forces in that sense. So I spent a lot of time at the National Defense University talking to people who were saying that resource flows might be important for the United States and sustainable sources of energy and supplies of oil from the Middle East. Again, remember, this is 1974. And so since then, I found immersion in the military culture and with your institutions to be always stimulating. Sometimes I've come to conclusions that were different from the people I've been talking with, but always it's made me take seriously the way that professionals in this branch of American life train for the broadest possible way to do their jobs. And so if journalists try hard, but if journalists prepared themselves as carefully as the military did, or business people, or politicians, or others, we would be in a better situation. The plan I'm going to do for my talk is I'm obviously not going to try to tell you anything about the operations of the military in which you are now either spending your lives or teaching people about how to spend their lives. Instead, I'm going to give you a parallel perspective from the view of somebody who has been interested in military affairs for a long time, has tried to explain them to a general public, and what implications I think that's having in American public discourse about how our military works. I'm going to talk about the origins of the article I did. I'm going to talk about the argument I tried to lay out, what I've learned since then, and then what that means for the announced topic of my talk this evening, which is what the military owes, what the country owes the military, and vice versa. First, I'm going to tell you a little bit about why I wrote the article that came out this year. Is there anybody who has not seen this article for whom I should be sure to sum up its argument? And don't feel shy, you can hold up your hand. There was, when I first joined The Atlantic magazine in 1979, I'd spent the previous 3 years working for Jimmy Carter. First as a writer for him on the campaign trail, and then for the first 2 years as a speechwriter in the White House. And if any of you are thinking of a second career in the glamorous business of political speechwriting, I'll give you this episode, which is a parallel to the Chapter 11 bankruptcy. When I signed on in the Carter campaign as a bushy-tailed young person, idealistic, I got my assignment of the very first thing I was to write in candidate Jimmy Carter's voice, which was an article for the NRA magazine called My First Kill by Jimmy Carter. It was about I got from him all the details of the squirrel he had mercilessly shot in southern Georgia. And it was a heartrending and yet heroic tale of a young man and his gun. So I'd been spending the previous 3 years doing that for candidate Carter and then President Carter. And one of the things that struck me as I left the administration to join the Atlantic before it came to its end, actually, Jimmy Carter was at his highest presidential point of popularity the week I left, which was either because I was still there or because it was the week of Camp David peace agreement, one or the other. And I thought that one of a structural problem for American public discourse was that the left side of public discourse, that is the Democratic Party, was not equipped to talk about the military. People in the Democratic Party, even though Jimmy Carter himself was a veteran, as you know, that they most of the politicians would say we just need to spend less on the military, we need to have fewer wars. The Republicans would mainly say we need to spend more on the military without much engagement on the realities that made troops effective or not effective in the field, that gave commanders the kind of training they needed, et cetera. And so the first long article I did for The Atlantic was the result of many months of reporting. It was published as The Muscle-Bound Superpower, and it was saying, if we were thinking not about more or less for the military, but about the lessons of actual combat and about ways money can be spent more or less effectively, et cetera, what would be the conclusions we would come to? And I interviewed an Air Force fighter pilot named John Boyd, some of you may have known of, and budget analysts and all the rest. And from that time onward, my work for The Atlantic in around the world and in Washington, D.C. has been sort of two interweaving strands. One of those strands has involved the welfare of the United States itself in terms of economics and culture and education and all the rest. The other strand has involved military issues of how we think about the right way to maintain the peace, to defend ourselves, to use the great power the United States has had. I spent a lot of time talking with Gary Hart in the 1980s during his time when he was talking about defense reform. In the years I spent living in Japan and China, one of the angles was to say, is the emergence of these countries affecting the military balance? What does it mean for the good and ill of the United States? Then, about a dozen years ago, when I was back in Washington from overseas, and in the aftermath of 9/11, most of the reporting I was doing for several years was on America's decision to go to war in Iraq and Afghanistan, the management of that war, the consequences, and otherwise. It's probably worth noting, because I'll come back to the Iraq debate later, a process of journalistic decision-making. And I'm going to tell you this story both because how other institutions work may not always be apparent from outside. I'm going to tell you how a journalistic organization works, and also because it's relevant to the way the Iraq discussion is coming back to our latest political decision making. So all of us remember September 11th, 2001. And in the aftermath of that, we at The Atlantic were deciding what to do. By January of 2002, our decision process in Washington is that whatever the official rhetoric coming out of the administration was, whatever the degree of congressional involvement had been, we knew for sure from all the signs we were getting that the decision had been made to go to war in Iraq. So starting in late January 2002 and early February, I began several months worth of reporting of people who were experts on Iraq, who were experts on occupation, who were experts on all sorts of things about what it would be like once the war was over. Now, the premise we made a year before the combat began was that the United States was going to war and that we would win the kinetic stage of the battle fairly quickly, and it would be worth then knowing what happened next. I mention this partly because this is the way monthly magazines with long lead times have to plan for things that we see coming in the future, but we think the newspapers aren't going to get around to, and also because there is a debate that's resuming now about when the decision to go to war in Iraq was made and on what basis. I did that kind of reporting for a couple of years. I decided to absent myself from that and come back and move to China, where I lived with my wife for 4+ years. And then on return to the United States about a couple of years ago, I was talking with my colleagues at the magazine about the specialty for magazines of our type, which is the stories that are hiding in plain sight. That is, the stories that are obvious once you point them out, but that day by day and week by week don't make their way into normal political discourse or the normal excellent coverage that some of our major newspapers and broadcast networks did. And the premise that we decided to investigate was the one that eventually led to my article, which I'll summarize this way, which was sort of the tagline of the article, saying that America has become what you could call insultingly a chicken hawk nation, and which I mean in fuller explanation, a nation willing to do anything for its military except take it seriously. And that was the argument I tried to put out in the article that followed. Some of the premises that were involved here, any of you who remember the article, I was starting with a scene of Barack Obama down in Tampa talking about his decision about more troops in Syria or someplace. I don't even remember where he was planning or thinking about talking about committing them then. And the announcement was we were not going to be committing troops there, and then he was going on to talking about honoring the heroes. What was so impressive to me as I watched this broadcast from O'Hare Airport with millions of other people there is that people gave their attention to the president for the 15 seconds in which he was announcing the news about whether the war is going to go on or not, and then everybody was back to his or her business with their iPhones, with their laptops, with their beers or their Cinnabons. And meanwhile, the military of the United States was in its business of more or less the longest period of open-ended war in our nation's history. And so this disjunction between a nation that is spending more on its military than other nations do, that has been at combat, at war for a longer time than it has been in its past, that is recognized as heroes during halftime ceremonies and things like that, but is not taken seriously by its nation in a variety of ways. And that is the dilemma or the situation I wanted to explain. Let me explain why I used the loaded term chicken hawk, which I knew to be poison when I used it, and we deliberately didn't use in the headline. I think that our magazine editors made a mistake, I will say, and then perhaps they made a prudent judgment. The headline they chose for this article was "The Tragedy of the American Military." Their mistake was the line they put on the cover after that, which was why the best soldiers in the world keep on losing. This was a mistake because it's something that I never said in the article itself. It's because 90% of the hostile reaction I got to the military was from people responding to that line. And it was and I'm sorry they did that, although these decisions are made in real time like many others. But the argument, the reason was probably better to call it the tragedy of the American military than Chicken Hawk Nation, which was actually the working title until it went to press, is that even fewer people might have stayed put for the argument if they just saw the words chicken hawk rather than why the best soldiers keep losing. But those who stayed, the argument I was trying to make was to define a chicken hawk nation as one that kept going to wars without thinking about them seriously. All of you think about them seriously. The 1% of the population that's in the military and their relatives think about it very seriously. The 0.75% of the American population that served in combat in Afghanistan or Iraq at any time take it very seriously. But the public as a whole, I contended, did not. And this, in ways I'll try to outline briefly here, was bad for the military, bad for the country, bad strategically, and deserved our collective attention. So to preempt any question that you may have been hatching in some of your minds about what the hell do you mean, why the best soldiers keep on losing, what I mean is, why do we keep choosing wars that we would not undertake if we were thinking, if the entire nation thought we're really committed here? So that's the argument there. So now what I'm going to do for the next stage of my talk is recap briefly how I think we got here, recap why I think this matters for the military and the public, and then go on to say, in some ways, then go on to say what I've learned since this article came out in the voluminous historic response we've got to the Atlantic from the article, and then I'll have the promised what to do section, We all know that in any diagnosis, it's true if you look at life, often there are things you can diagnose without necessarily having a prescription. But in all of our public discourse, there always has to be a what to do about it section. So I'll get to that later on, but I'm going to briefly review how I think we got here and why that matters, what the consequences are, what I've learned since the article had come out, and then what we might all do with it. In the how we got here, we all recognize, and especially you as members of an academic institution now, that history, the historical background depends on when you cut off the history. And if you cut off history essentially with my lifetime as one of the baby boomer generation, you think that where we are today is a sort of either a shift or a decline from a historical norm of post-World War II, post the mass mobilization war of World War II, we had a country very deeply connected to its military because most able-bodied males served in the military then. The cohort that came of age during the 1950s was small. The military requirements were large, so you had the broad experience of military service, and things have declined since then in terms of the connection. Those of you who start history at an earlier time know that you can define the norm for American life in many different ways. America of the pre-Civil War era was different, of course, during the Teddy Roosevelt era. So I'm not saying that the military of the Korean War, Vietnam War era is the norm for American society, but it is one in which we can compare modern life. And the military that took on the scale of the one you're all part of and the commitments it has worldwide that you all carry out is one that was born in that time where a large military was connected in broad ways to the public that was paying for it and was serving in it. One of the cultural points I tried to make is that when the military was as broadly connected to America as it was for 20 plus years after World War II, it had the traits of other broadly representative institutions, whether we're thinking about school boards or the medical system or even the DMV, something that everybody has some exposure to. And those institutions, as we know, are not universally respected or loved, but people understand the range of experience. If you talk about going to the doctor, if you talk about a TSA line, if you talk about schools, people have some frame of reference. And during that time, in the 50s and 60s and through the early 70s, I argued that people were supportive of the military. They understood the collective heroism that it had demonstrated in World War II and afterwards and in Korea, and the many acts of individual heroism that men and women had carried out, without assuming that the institution was perfect or different from other human organizations or made uniformly of heroes. And if you think of any of the mass cultural representations of the American military during this time of broad participation, they all show this range of human life. Think of Catch 22, for example, in which half the people in the military had these little side scams going on, or Sergeant Bilko, if any of you are old enough like me to remember that, or the musical South Pacific and all the different schemes that people had going on, or the bridges at Toko Ri, or TV shows like McHale's Navy, or Gomer Pyle, or F Troop, or whatever else. And so my view of small d democratic society is that it works when people are connected to the results. For the last year or so, my wife and I have been flying around the country in our little Cirrus airplane, looking at small communities that have had economic or cultural shocks and how they've recovered. And the ones that recover are ones where there's some connection between most people and the welfare of the town. They can see it's worth investing in the school system, or it's worth trying to bring back industries or whatever else. And for better and worse, I argue that during the time of mass military connection, there was that respectful but irreverent view of the military. We took it seriously enough not to worship it. And our most experienced military president, Dwight Eisenhower, obviously respected the military, but knew the ways in which it had its systematic flaws. For reasons I don't need to go into in elaborate detail now, clearly the big phase change came during the Vietnam War. As Richard Nixon, as any of you alive then recall was very deliberate in his determination to end the draft because it had been a source of such friction about the Vietnam War. And he was deliberately looking for a way in which the executive would have a freer hand to have commitment of military force, because you would no longer have people in the military who you had to threaten with arrest, you know, to get them in there. You wouldn't have all the problem training problems that were coming in the 1970s, et cetera, et cetera. And so you had the beginning of the institution that I assume almost everybody here has spent almost all of his or her professional life in. As a side note, when I was living in China, a point that students of the PLA made to me, the People's Liberation Army, is that whatever else is going on there, the PLA has almost no combat veterans in it, because their last serious combat was in the early 1980s. It's good they haven't had combat since then, but it also means the features for a military of people who don't have the experience that the U.S. military has from its constant exposure. And something similar is happening now with the increasing gyre, the increasing division between the country at large and the military itself. Operationally, there's no doubt that what's happening now is better for the military in terms of day by day. You have better recruits, easier training, fewer discipline problems, a higher caliber of people, all the things that I don't need to tell you. There also is the fact of scale differences, that so many more people turn 18 each year than the military could possibly absorb, that the idea of a mass draft would be implausible. But from a civic point of view, I argued, that was the beginning of what I now call the chicken hawk era, when it's become too easy for politicians and too easy for the public to say, yeah, let's go put some boots on the ground, let's go to war, and then say, you know, who are the Mets playing tonight? That it's not connected to the nation in a way that's been during the time of the post-World War II era. That's the change. And again, I could give you more details here. You know them, but I'm just going to leave that. The main change is the historic post-Vietnam change towards an army that has ended up being small in number, fewer than 1% of the population are in uniform, concentrated regionally and by family. You all know families who are military families. We published a map on The Atlantic showing the counties of the U.S. which had high military participation and high military casualties in the last dozen years, and the other areas that didn't, and it's very quite striking. So that's the fruit we have borne in this era of the long, long wars. Why does this matter? I'm going to just touch briefly on topics, each one of which I'd be happy to defend or elaborate if you'd like, but I think this is the range of reasons why what I'm calling deliberately the chicken hawk nation phenomenon is bad for you and bad for us and bad for the world. First, and I think most importantly, it's bad in terms of policy, in that there's a predisposition to careless wars. My argument about the 2 years after the 9/11 attacks is that what was initially a justified and well-considered and necessary strike against Taliban sites in Afghanistan spread into a much more encompassing war in a way that it never would have if there were a broader sense that the country was at stake. Now, yes, of course, we all know there were the wave of heroic enlistments in the time after the 9/11 attacks. We know that there was a sense that the nation in general was endangered and people wanted to help. There was that mood, irreverently, I'll say, the moment I knew that the 9/11 era had passed was about 9 weeks later when I was driving on the Washington Beltway and somebody gave me the finger in traffic. I knew that was when I marked the 9/11 time. But it's beyond that. I think that the commitments of the last dozen years, I think, would have been different if there's some way that the nation as a whole felt that individuals, that families who were not themselves in uniform had a connection through tax payments, through relatives, through some other sense of their being at stake in wars the nation was undertaking. I know that people in your business spend a lot of time, as I have, around the world. Most people in the United States do not realize how much America's image in the world now is shaped by the fact of our wars of the past dozen years. Now, what I've learned by living overseas is I am purely an American. After going to graduate school in England, my main conclusion was our greatest war was the Revolutionary War. And we had to get rid of that queen and the royal family. But patriot that I am sobered around the world and recognizing the effect of what our decade of open-ended war has done to our image and reputation. Most people in the country don't recognize that because they're not connected to it. And when we say on the cover of our magazine, why do we keep losing? In my view, it's because we keep undertaking wars that the public, if properly involved, would recognize we can't really win, or at least not win on the terms that we would undertake. I think a second factor of this disconnect, in my view, is spending that is both excessive and ineffective. You can have ever-growing military budgets and still shortages of the most routine and necessary spare parts and training and all the rest. It's probably worth recognizing that we know that the United States is the richest country in the world. It's important for us to have a big military budget. If you take the, and we also know that our spending as a share of GDP has gone down from its height after World War II. But still, the United States' share of GDP that goes to the military even now is about twice the average of the rest of the world. It's not just that we spend more one by one, we spend twice as much as the average for even China, even Russia, and all the rest. An illustration that I was having to defend a couple of days ago to the head of the F-35 program, when I was seeing him in the JPO office, was that the Solyndra scandal, which became so famous during the previous election cycle, the entire amount of federal spending that went into the Solyndra project was less than the overruns on the F-35. And yet Solyndra is this huge issue, and the F-35 is sort of a background noise for most of the public. Again, I think most people in the public don't have a sense of where the money is going. They're not taxed for it. They're not exposed to its operating realities. I think a third consequence of this divide is something that I know is part of your life day by day, which is often wonderment about the kinds of weapons that are actually procured and the ones that day by day are effective, that do the job, and I go into that in great length in my article. I'll just skip past that to another and more sensitive one, I'm sure, for everybody here, and one that when I was doing interviewing, this was the one that the end, after four beers or late at night, my friends who are career military would say that this is what really worried them, was a sense that within the military, the system of excellence and accountability was not working the way it should because they knew that the public wasn't paying attention. I know this is something that's on the minds of everybody here. I'll simply say that viewed institutionally, viewed the way a historian might, I think there'd be a case that the separation of the large, professional, excellent military from this rich country means that the standards of accountability that one would have for success in combat, for success in leadership, and all the rest, don't seem to be different from historical norms. You're all familiar with the study showing that during all of America's previous wars, a number of flag officers were relieved for failures in command. Most of the famous cases of flag officers in trouble these days involve what we think of as scandal of one kind or another, whether it's sexual or financial or some other sort. And we recognize that any institution has good and bad leaders, and we recognize they need to be held accountable. The press is always drumming people out. Politicians are good and bad. In the last decade, in the chicken hawk era, I would argue, it's been harder for the military to have what had traditionally been its standards of genuine accountability and excellence for the people who are rising to the top. And finally, I will say, of the consequences of a chicken hawk nation, we have a social distortion that historians writing about our age will note. Many of you know a retired Army officer named John Noggle. He was a hotshot. He was a Rhodes Scholar. He was a prominent young officer in the Army. He left. he argued to me that actually this is the best of possible worlds now, because he was saying the United States, any quasi-imperial power, taking all pejorative terms away from that, pejorative meanings away from imperial, any power with worldwide reach needs to have a Praetorian Guard of people who will do the hard work, and the general public can't really be bothered to have ones to say, this person should be on duty here, this person should be on duty there. So he said this is good. While I respect and like him, I profoundly disagree, and I think from distant perspective, I would imagine almost none of you would think it's a good thing in the long run to have a public that cheers the heroes but doesn't pay attention to where the heroes are sent and what they are doing. And I'll give you these illustrations of why this disconnect is bad in policy terms. During the debates between Barack Obama and Mitt Romney about during the previous presidential time, there was essentially zero discussion of military budgets, military spending. The only discussion, as you may recall, was Romney saying we have fewer ships than we used to in the Navy, and Obama saying, well, yeah, we have fewer cavalry too. And it was a nice little sort of moment for a debate parry, but that was the extent of the military debate. The latest budget that came out of one of the House authorizing committees was 61-0 approving it. This was the same House that has a hard time passing a highway bill. It's very striking to me that the current debate, if you will, about the Iraq war seems to have reduced itself to whether the intelligence reports were flawed. The question that's being asked all the candidates in sort of gotcha mode is, knowing what we know now, would you have done it? Not about all the other mechanics that went in there, how the war was fought. I'm not aware of any. I know that many people in this room have written important books and articles assessing the military lessons of the past dozen years. I assert that almost none of that has made its way into our politics, and that is a result, in my view, of the chicken hawk phenomenon. So I'm saying that because of this gap in which the public makes up for its lack of attention to the military by adulation, that if you say hero often enough, then you don't have to actually think about what people are doing. The result of that is bad for you, bad for the country, bad for the world, and bad. If that is so, what might be done? I'm going to give you a brief message of what I've been saying to my civilian colleagues, and then what I think would be the implications for the military itself. For the civilian public, this argument tends to short-circuit itself, saying, oh, you must want a draft. And the argument is, there's not going to be a draft. Absent some invasion from Mars or something that really changes the strategic calculus, the United States is not going to have a military draft. Apart from Charlie Rangel and one other person, I think are in favor of a draft, but that's it within the Congress. The cost is such, the scale is such that it's not going to happen. So that's not even an argument worth having because it's not going to occur. Instead, I think for the civilian public, it's worth recognizing that this is another long-term challenge without a fix like the draft, where the matter is that the solution is not changing rules or have some one-time fix that will change things, but rather shifting norms over time so that politicians will find it, there'll be more reward in talking about military policy. The press will pay more attention to this. There'll be more attention to service. I think styles and the way people live their lives and set examples have a big effect. I think it's all the efforts to try to make people more willing to serve without mandatory service are important. And I'll give you this example. I have an Atlantic colleague named Ta-Nehisi Coates. If any of you don't know him, you should pay attention to him. He's a very, very important rising writer. He wrote a very influential piece in our magazine 6 months ago called The Case for Reparations, essentially arguing the history of legalized segregation and discrimination was such that it still is going on, and he's been writing a lot about Baltimore recently. There's not a fix for what he wants. He's trying to change the consciousness, the norms, the awareness of this ongoing challenge to be dealt with. And for the civilian public, that's what I'm trying to do too. I'm trying to have reporters pay more attention to this. Politicians find some advantage in talking about military as part of their standard kit of things to talk about, of having institutions reward service, of having other ways to say, this is the direction we're going to go and not that direction. If I were in the military, what would I do? I'm going to introduce this by telling you about the response I've gotten to this article, and then I'll come to what would be the only payoff for military members in the audience. This article came out just after Christmas last year, and within the first day or so it was online, I'd gotten about 1,000 email responses. I've gotten about 15,000 now. What is striking to me has been, number one, their excellence. These are people who've spent, you know, there was always the normal fringe of the, oh, you jerk, we hate you type of response. This is part of the public life, as you all know. But I'd say 90% of these were long, carefully argued, paragraph sort of spaced cases for how this or that person had experienced this when on a Navy, when serving in the Navy, what this or that person felt about his own Korean War experience, what this or that person felt about designing certain weapons. So there was this deep well of people making arguments about a topic that in most media accounts, most mainstream media accounts or most political accounts was not really part of the mainstream discussion. That was the first thing that impressed me. The second thing that impressed me in a good and bad way was that 90%, so 90% are excellent, and of those, 90% were from people either now in the military or recently in the military. If you consider that 1% of the public is in the military, that's an interesting disproportion. It was striking to me because these were people in the institution thinking very carefully about its welfare and its future. It was depressing to me that the other 99% of the public was not writing in very much, you know, sort of confirming the argument I was trying to make that there was this disconnect. Of the 90% that were excellent, and the 90% of those that were from the military are now down to 81%. I'll let you all do the math from this point onward. I'd say that 90 then percent, you know, 90 to the third now, 90% of those were basically positive, saying, yeah, you don't know the half of it. Oh, things are really bad. Let me tell you this. Here's what I hate, et cetera. One person was saying that every time he heard thank you for your service, every time somebody said to him, thank you for your service, what he heard was shut up and get back to the foxhole. So you know, 90% were of that sort. But the ones who were angriest were either the ones who misunderstood the cover line about continuing to lose, or those who said, you have undersold what the military is doing for itself now. One of the things I argued in the piece was that in the aftermath of Vietnam, which was devastating for the country and for the military, as some of you will recall, there was a profound reaction, both destructive and constructive, within the military. Many of the people who are recently retired officers or senior officers were very young people then, and they knew the soul searching and the examination and the recriminations and the serious work that happened in the military through the late 70s and much of the 80s, trying to say, we've been through the first major defeat of American history, and after we got to get over the anger and the blame, what do we learn from this? And so I argued in the piece that there was a really profound reform movement in the military after the trauma of Vietnam. I asserted in the piece that we had not yet seen that after the long wars, that there was an increasing corpus of excellent literature, both journalistic and academic, and from witnesses on the scene, from soldiers and Marines and airmen and sailors who had been there, but there had not been yet, I argued, the same kind of internal cleansing process we saw be so powerful after Vietnam. I probably shouldn't have said that, or I should have said it differently. I should have said that there was not enough of it yet, or there needed to be more, because the part of the response I got that was angry from the military and that I took seriously was from people saying, yes, we're doing what you say. We recognize that this is a structural moment unlike any other in the military's history. We recognize that our record over the past dozen years has not been successful for the nation, even though we've been brave and sacrificed. We recognize that there is a broader range of good to bad officers, than the public discusses. We recognize that this is a time of reckoning too. And so I, as a journalist, plan to be giving more attention and time and airspace to those people who are saying, yes, the new reform movement is beginning. And if I were in the military, I guess what I'd be doing is not simply continuing the efforts of institutions like this to connect people from different services, different walks of life, civilian and military in different countries of the world, but also to foster the sense that at this stage in America's military history, and its military civil history, civic history, the imperative is on, it's a time with where history's obligation and attention on the military is for this to be another reform era. And to have, to make that be known, to foster and encourage the young people who are saying, yes, we have to learn X, Y, and Z, to have them be involved with the universities and with the politicians and with the reporters saying, yes, rather than just wanting to have another salute to the heroes exercise, we're going to have let's learn from the last long years. I know this is starting. Before any of you stand up to say, oh, you're so wrong, we're already doing these things, I'm glad you're doing them. I hope there are more. I think this is the main way the military can try to re-knit the fabric, not by getting more people in uniform necessarily, because that's not going to happen, not by having more parades, but by showing that that people in this institution are aware of this strained moment in history, are trying to find ways that all of you can rebuild the institution or the lessons of the last dozen years. And I think there will be attention from the press and from politicians and from the general public if this becomes the news of the next stage of the military's career. So what does the country owe its military? The country owes its military that it will take it seriously. Taking it seriously in terms of how the military is committed, how it is equipped, how it is paid, how people are taken, how cared for after they serve or if they're injured or their families. And so the general public has failed in the obligation to take the military seriously. And I've been doing what I can to address that. What the military owes the public, I think, apart from the things you all know and all practice now of discipline and fitness and strategy and planning and all the other things that are part of your whole professionalism, is to recognize that it's a historical moment that is shifting. And it's a time when the military, I think, like the country, needs to learn from the way you've been exposed over the past dozen years and join the rest of the country in a genuine exercise of how do we go to war, when we go to war, what are the limits, what are the tactics, what are the training. We all need some accounting for the wars of the past dozen years, and I think that will be a means towards having the country fulfill its duty. It'll be one step of having the country fulfill its duty of taking the military seriously. There is more I could say, but I've talked for a long time, so let me now pause to take any complaints within reason, any questions, any areas for elaboration, but simply I'll close by saying I'm very grateful that you all are bringing me up here, that you're doing me the honor of showing up, that you're hearing me out at this great length, and after an institutional critique of the kind that I was putting out in the magazine, I appreciate the graciousness and open-mindedness and engagement with what I found here. So sincere thanks for having me here. I'll be happy to continue the discussion in any way that you would like. Thank you. Good. So actually, I might start by asking you all one question. Who has a better idea for repairing this divide than these kind of hazy ones I had? Who has a better idea? Yes, or at least, we have a microphone. Yes.
Hello, sir. Lieutenant Commander Randy Geyer, United States Navy. So I'm not saying that my idea is a better one. I'm just saying that I think that it could be a possible one.
Yeah.
I think that we're a victim, the military is a victim of our own success, and not just the military, but probably the National Security Agency and the other people that keep the United States free of terrorism in our within our borders. Winston Churchill, from what I understand, was glad to see that the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor because then we had committed to the war. So I know it's not appropriate to talk about hypotheticals in an argument, but I would say that if we were attacked on a monthly, a weekly basis along the lines of something that happened in Oklahoma City or even what potentially could have happened in Dallas, that the American public would take the military more seriously and we would have a better relationship with how we use our forces, how we outfit our military, so that they were weekly, monthly engaged in the wars that are happening around the world. I think that it's kind of like when you watch the news in the evening, there's so much violence that shows on the TV about what's happening around America, but if it's not happening to you, then it's just something that you kind of tune out. And so for the military, we can't tune it out because we don't know when we're going on the next right. mission, but they can tune it out. Now, if we had something happen on a weekly basis or a monthly basis, if ISIS starts sending their folks back here and we start seeing some of those things, I think that we'll have the connection you're looking for.
I was asking for a better idea. That's a very serious point. Let me say a couple things in response. First, we're going to hear a lot in the next year and a half from presidential candidates. They're going to say, I don't want to deal with hypotheticals. Whenever they say that, we should respond, cut the BS. Everything about running to become president is about hypotheticals. It's about how they're going to deal with challenges we don't know about yet. So don't let any candidate say, I'm not going to get into hypotheticals. So that's point number one. Point number two, it's really interesting when you say if there were attacks like Oklahoma City or the other places, it's really intriguing the threats and challenges societies decide to become sensitive to or not. There's something like, 40 people a day shot to death in the United States and 100 a day who die in car crashes. And so in a week's time, there's a considerable toll, but it's interesting the kinds of things that become that we define as terrorism. I know there's a lot that is irrational in people's response to threats, but that also is intriguing of what we think of as dangers. A side note here, I was mentioning earlier in the session about China that the latest figure is something like a million plus people in China per year are dying prematurely because of pollution. If there were a million people who were, a million person threat, that's a huge toll, even in China. And so if there was some kind of other threat that was causing that to them, they would think this is war. On your basic premise of people are attuned to things that affect them directly, yes, of course, that's right. And Israel, of course, is a society that lives with this sort of threat all the time, and people both, they have a lot of security about it, but also a kind of resilience. There's going to be a certain toll and you try to kind of go on. You open up the restaurant 2 hours after it's bombed and things like that. For the United States, if you're saying if the war came home in a sense, if more of these attacks were visited inside the United States, that would be a kind of Pyrrhic victory because of course the success that you're all doing is keeping that from happening within here. I guess I fear that the reaction in the U.S. would be more negative than positive if that happened. The civil liberties balance would be set differently and all the rest. So taking seriously the thought experiment you pose, I think we're going to have to find some other way than sort of dismantling the Border Patrol or the watch list or all that. But you're right. If there was a different sense of the civil liberties balance after 9/11 than there was in the long run, I think the ratchet was set too far towards security in the immediate aftermath of 9/11, because in the long run, a free society is going to encounter some risks. But it's a very interesting thought experiment that you have. And yes, thank you. Yes.
Megan Iverson from the Office of Naval Intelligence. To your question, what is a better way to address these concerns? I believe that the national security community owes the military clear goals and strategies, what they want to achieve overseas. What are our goals in the Asia Pacific? And quid pro quo, I believe that our military owes the public a phase three plan. Shaping and keeping the status quo are not an option in the future security environment. We face three major existential threats: the rise of a near peer competitor in the Chinese, radical jihadism, and the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction. With guidance, we can shape our forces to address these threats and determine what the security environment should look like post-combat. But until we talk about a post-combat world and what that looks like and define those combat situations, you're only going to try to keep putting that toothpaste back in the tube.
Thank you. That's very, very interesting, too. So I will simply stipulate for later argument, we can argue later, having lived in China for a long time, I don't view them as an existential threat, apart from what their environmental destruction is doing to everyone. But that's for later. I stipulate we see that differently, and I understand you see it in a different way. My answer to your question is yes, comma, but. And of course, there needs to be clear guidance. I mean, you all are in the business, many of you are in the business of kinetic solutions to things, where there's a sort of zero versus 100 outcome. The thing is destroyed or it's not. The forces are committed or they're not. And the last thing you need is sort of tentative, well, maybe type suggestions from political leadership. I think it is the nature of life, the nature of politics, the nature of the soupy world in which we live, that's any political leaders of any party in any circumstance are going to give you less of that than you would like to have. Because they always want to keep options open. They always want to have gray areas. They all want to do this or that. So I think the military is, if the hope is for crystal clear guidance from the political leadership of the kind you would want internally, it's simply not going to happen. You know, except during actual engaged large-scale war where the big decisions have been made. And so the question, if all of life is living with uncertainty and living with the certainty of we know in the long run we're all dead, the military analog to that is living with the certainty of uncertain political guidance. I think that just is, I think time we've spent hoping for something different is worthwhile as hope, but not as a plan, because it's I think it's not really going to be whoever is in control. I think that's the nature of the shifting world. So there are certain things. I'll give you one example that, like some other comments I've made, might be controversial here. I think that for the foreseeable future, the best outcome between the People's Republic and Taiwan is just letting things go without rocking the boat on either side. There's a famous story about a British economist who was taken to see a factory, and he saw all their new techniques, and he said, "Well, that's all fine in practice, but what about in theory?" So it's the same, I think, between China and between the PRC and Taiwan. In theory, they simply cannot get along at all. There's a complete zero-sum conflict between them. In practice, day by day and month by month, the connections increase. So that's a place where it would be frustrating to have that status quo guidance, but it may be what even a wise political leader would give you. So I understand and sympathize with the wish you're expressing, and I think political leaders should do a better job of being clear, but I think that you will need to live in the sort of the world of frustration with limited clarity and guidance, and I'm sorry to say it, but this is the voice of grizzled age. So,
sir?
Yes, sorry. Yes.
Kevin Matthews, United States Marine Corps. First of all, thank you for the speech. That was really great. I'd like to start by saying that I read your article the day it came out, and it was actually the subtitle that caught my eye and why I read it. Yeah. And I might not have read it had not been for that.
The wisdom of my editors.
Yeah. So I was going to say thank you, editors, for putting that on there. Yeah. But there are two things that I think need to be addressed. And the first one is that thing about thank you for your service. I get concerned about that because I feel like people are afraid of me. I get a sense that people are afraid of the military, that they're afraid to challenge the American military leadership. Yeah. And what we get is kind of a lack of dialogue here and people, yeah, accountability for performance. So that's the first thing. And then the other thing, I'm actually a libertarian, so you'll be shocked when I say this here, but I think that we need to pay for the wars and these operations that we undertake, that by financing and giving me a tax refund at the end of the year and tax cuts, this really doesn't, you don't get that accountability, yeah, from the folks, because, yeah, we're never going to go to a draft, right? But yeah, if I got money in this thing here, I want results. Yeah.
So if you could address that. So to start with the second, I agree entirely. And actually, I could imagine a political candidate putting myself in the role of a one-time speechwriter, having that as part of his or her platform. You know, we're going to have an actual, we're going to go to wars, we're going to pay for them. And if we're not going to war, you know, there'll be this account, and either you'll get money back or you'll pay money in, depending on where we're going to war. And I think that's one way to get people's attention. So a hard lesson of politics is you never say you're going to raise taxes, but this might be wacky enough for somebody to say. But I think it's also, it's something that the founding fathers would have thought was a good way to connect the public to its wars. I agree with you. I think most people who've grown up in the volunteer army era and themselves are not of it are basically afraid of the military. You know, they're afraid of being disrespectful. They think that there is a kind of, using this term in an advised way, more manly than they are, you know, male or female, there's a kind of, there's something that is better about people in the military. And this is an unwholesome relationship that is sublimated in different ways. You know, of too much worship, too little criticism. Here's one more thing that many people here might not agree with, but I'm going to say it anyway. I think that when President Obama came into office, I believe he was imprisoned by this when it came to the Afghanistan operation. He was reluctant to challenge the military people who said, yes, we got to make a new effort in Afghanistan. I think if he... comparable leaders of other institutions, he would have been more willing to challenge. I think that's generally true of the intellectual civilian leadership, that they are, they're just unfamiliar with the military and therefore just having all the relationships, all the reactions to say. So a challenge for all of us is how to rebuild a healthy relationship absent a mass military service, which is not going to be the case. And I think anything which sort of increases exposure familiarity is to that end, but thank you very much for saying that. Yes. So yes, here. Yeah.
Hi, Commander Michelle Poole. I was just wondering what you think the role of the veterans community has to play in helping to bridge this divide. And just three quick examples. I think I was reading today, there's an article about the post-9/11 GI Bill, and if you look at Georgetown's National Security Master's Degree Program, of the students are military veterans, and you see that at Harvard Business School and really sort of scattered across all the universities in the United States. Number two is organizations like The Mission Continues, which takes veterans and puts them in community service projects. And then lastly, members of Congress who, veterans as members of Congress who are serving across the political spectrum and certainly haven't proven themselves too shy at calling, raising a flag when necessary to ask the hard questions of the military.
Yes, those are great points too, and I think that is a great prospect. You know, there was a time when the military veterans were underrepresented in Congress. Right now, the veterans of recent wars are overrepresented. You know, it's about 1% of the population that was in Iraq or Afghanistan, but now 5% of the Congress, and they're of varied political hues. Tammy Duckworth and Tom Cotton being the sort of two poles of that. So I think it's good to have. Through American history, military veterans have played large political roles, so I think this is a good thing. As my wife and I have traveled around the country, the part of America's educational system we've become most excited about is actually community colleges and vocational schools. And these are ways that people, the sort of divide of America into the plutocrat class and the McDonald's class, there is sort of an option for people who are not going to become plutocrats of $23 an hour jobs as repairmen or whatever. And they are engaging seriously the veterans community in lots of places. And Howard Schultz of Starbucks has tried to pioneer some of this. So I think this is also a good positive suggestion of ways where an interesting psychological twist in this way. Just as I was saying earlier, there's a not just the proper respect for military service, but an unhealthy deference to the military among a lot of our civilian leadership. I think for the veterans community, there's a combination of a proper respect and an excessive pity, a sense of, you know, the people who are disabled or mentally troubled or whatever else. And so the trick there is to find ways to rebuild the fabric for the proper respect and then paying societies proper dues and support for people who have served. But that's also a very good idea. Thank you. I should have interviewed all of you before I did this piece, but then you wouldn't have read it. So, yes, sir.
Sir Major Robinson, Marines. Sir, much of the military's recruiting is beginning to recognize a value-based change with younger generations. Arguing that perhaps building the awareness that you're talking about, you know, short of a draft, building the awareness, exposing people to this argument, may be too late once they're a little bit more mature. Do you have any ideas about how to build that awareness in younger generations that may be going through a value-based change?
This is something where I understand what you're asking, and it's a serious question. This is the rare good news part of my presentation. It's been quite striking around the country to see locally based local service organizations or the AmeriCorps operation. Just about a month ago, we were in Arizona seeing an AmeriCorps team of people from a really wide variety of backgrounds, from Indian reservations to Harlem to whatever, doing these volunteer projects. And I think there is more of that remaining value than one might think. And I think that my observation is the main limit to those people joining the military is the military's own standards, you know, that their educational standards and health standards and all that. So your experience may be different, but I think there is a more of a renaissance. If there's a values-based change, there may be more of a positive counter surge than we may have thought. I'll give you just one illustration. I've been writing recently about a town called San Bernardino, California. I don't know if any of you know it. It's right near where I grew up. It's about as hard-pressed a town as there is in the United States now. It's lost all its employment. It's bankrupt. Everything is bad about San Bernardino. But there's a group of mid and late 20-something people there, mainly Latino or Black, who are saying, this is our home, we're going to make something of it. And they just spend all their time trying to, in sort of a civilian conservation corps type way, to remake this really beleaguered community. I'm not trying to cherry pick illustrations, I'm just saying that there are signs of what I think you would want to see as a spirit of service in the United States among younger people. So that's not really an answer to your question, but it's the best answer I have. Yes, sir.
Sir, Major Eric Kao, United States Marine Corps. Sir, to pose a question to your question about what's a better way, being a reservist, I'm very lucky to be amongst the civilian populace. And being a Philadelphian myself, I've spoken many times to many congressional delegates about the military.
Yep.
I found it very interesting when I would go from my home neighborhood of Northeast Philadelphia and go all the way out to the main line, which is way more affluent. The reception, the questions I got were vastly different.
Oh.
So I would pose a question to you is like, how do you feel about a talent tax to make sure that every congressional district is represented by a limited draft, not a full draft?
In principle, that would be great. And so let me explain anything like that would enmesh us more as a society, I'd be in favor of. As a practical matter, for that to happen, some president has to endorse it, and a majority in the House and Senate have to vote for it. And so my observation of national politics is anything difficult is not going to happen. And just as sort of a general principle. This is difficult, therefore, by my principle, it won't happen. And the question is, what could you do short of actually passing legislation to make this work? And you could have universities in each of these districts. The universities are disproportionately concentrated in the kinds of places you're talking about. They could give scholarships, more and more of their scholarships for military service or whatever. So I think that if we have, as a thought experiment, the goal of an actual system, we recognize that's not going to happen. And so then how close can we get to that through other means, recognizing that legislation passed by both houses and signed is not in the world we know going to occur. So that's actually very interesting. And I think it would be worth having networks of the military working with, like, you know, the Ivy League presidents, then the other sort of fancy university leaders, say, how can we increase the connection? I know that a number of these institutional leaders, they think they should do that and are looking for ways to do it. But that's an interesting idea, too. Did I give you all my 15-second theory of America? Here it is. Everything about America actually is going better than you think, except the workings of national government. You know, that we're dealing with a system whose rules were set 200 plus years ago that we can't change and that are no longer functional. You know, when the Constitution was written, the most populous state had 10 times as many people as the least populous state. Now it's 70-1. Madison and all would never have had an equal representation for the Senate with a 70-1 disproportion. But that's how we are. We can't change it. So anything that involves national government functioning will leave you discouraged. And so the question is, where below national government function? Now, I realize for members of the military, that may be a depressing thing to say, but I'm just passing it on. That's my theory. Yes, sir.
Derek Coker, Lieutenant Commander, U.S. Navy, recently retired. So the solution, going back to your original question, the solution that I would pose to the chicken hawk dilemma is that we need to get the American public more engaged in what's going on in the world. They seem to be very disengaged. If you're sitting in your living room in America and you want to become educated on what's going on or what happened in that in any given day throughout the world, you have to try very hard. You got to get online. If you try to see something on the news, you're more likely than not to see stories about your neighborhood or your state, even on the world news programs that are going on. So any kind of educational changes that I think that would get people more aware about the world, interested in it, and get them to get out and Peace Corps programs, something, so they take an interest, I think would be a step in the right direction.
Yeah, that's a great idea, and it's sort of indirect solution to the problem we're talking about. If Americans know more about the world, they will naturally be more aware of what you're doing and our military presence in the world. Living overseas, I'm always encouraged by the number of young Americans I see teaching English, starting business, traveling around, smoking dope, whatever. You know, they're around the world. And I think that anything that makes this, so I think I have a figure in my story saying that something like twice as many people will do a junior year abroad this year as join the military, or some comparison like that. That also is a worthwhile sort of part of the arsenal of any private incentives for people to do this. Again, we're talking about incentives and norms because requirements aren't going to work. But if it's expanding the Peace Corps, expanding junior year abroad, expanding the expectation that people will see the world, whenever some younger person makes the mistake of asking me for life advice, one of the things I always say is before the age of 25, make sure you spend at least 1 year, but preferably two, living outside the country, just because there's no way you can understand the U.S. without doing that. So yes, that's a very good part of the solution too. So at least we're getting a solution set of a wide range of different things to do. We can plug this into some candidate's campaign, or all the candidates' campaigns, or one of you all can have a report. Yes, sir, in the back.
Yes, sir. Lieutenant Haney, United States Navy. Like the Lieutenant Commander, if you watch Jay Leno, for instance, in jaywalking, you know, they'll ask basic questions and the average American has no clue. Yep. Rather than focusing primarily on the military, maybe reshape it to government as a whole, where you bring in the public education system, starting from grade school all the way through high school, where you have a more active role in history, current affairs, as well as government, and how students play a role in their good government, as well as, you know, civilians in the society, and maybe have some type of exercises in coordination with the government where you'll write your congressman or you'll take trips to D.C. and get them more involved. Because right now, I don't think most of the population realizes what power they do have. I mean, right. I'd like to know what percent writes their congressman or their governor.
That also is a very good idea. And it's interesting, I think, how we're seeing all the different parts of the national realm of instruments of power and improvement are all we're talking about all of them, which is actually this is very interesting to me and encouraging to hear all the different things that you all are saying. On public education, let me say another surprisingly positive thing. I know what you mean about jaywalking. You just want to kill yourself when you see that. I did a story for The Atlantic a couple of years ago whose subtitle was, "Are We Going to Hell?" about whether America was falling apart. And I interviewed a woman named, who you may have followed, named Jill Lepore, who's an American historian at Harvard. When I was an undergraduate at Harvard, I studied American history. It's something that I've paid attention to. So I said, what about Americans' state of knowledge of the world? And she said, the bad news is that Americans are appallingly ignorant. The good news is they always have been. You know, this is that it's just tests of civics, you know, have always been bad. You can sort of look back and see things, college entrance exams from the 1910s that were higher level, but most people were illiterate then or weren't in schools or whatever. So she was arguing there's a kind of constant level of ignorance in our national birthright, and that we're seeing more of it because of jaywalking. That doesn't mean we should be happy with it, you know, as you say. And so I'll give you one other example of civic engagement. This town of San Bernardino, I mentioned, one of the reasons it's now in bankruptcy is that it's the poorest town in California, and its pay for police and firemen is the highest in the state. And the reason is the police and firemen about 50 years ago got through a civic charter saying that their pay would be indexed to that in Pasadena and Oceanside and La Jolla and San Mateo, you know, the towns that are way, way, way richer than San Bernardino. And the only way to overturn that was with a civic sort of constitutional amendment, and nobody votes there. So they can't overturn it. Now, if anybody would get out and vote, and these young people I mentioned, they're trying to organize people to vote to overturn that. So yes, consistent with what I was saying earlier, that there's no one solution, there's the ongoing challenge of looking for lots of different answers. I think what you mentioned is a very good idea too. So I'm getting more encouraged the longer I'm here. Yes, sir.
Sir, Captain Doug Howell, U.S. Navy, thanks for your presentation tonight. I feel we've had an opportunity this year to look in the mirror as security professionals, but with your background, maybe we have a chance to look through a window at American journalism, at its ethics, at its accountability. And you've had an extraordinary opportunity, presidential level, overseas, here domestically, to see trends in American journalism. What broad trends and what insights can you offer, maybe we can employ,
right,
both as currently serving officers and in the future when we're full-time citizens again, that might help reknit this fabric you spoke of?
That's a great question, too. So, lest you think I am a Pollyanna about my own business, I wrote a book 15 years ago called Breaking the News, How the Media Undermine American Democracy, and sort of went on from there and talked about the ways in which when the media present public affairs as just like a more boring form of professional wrestling. You know, that it's just you have candidates and they just sort of make fun of them for the mistakes they make, as opposed to recognizing these are the people who will send us to war or not, they'll raise our taxes, et cetera. They repel people from politics, from public life, because if you just want to be entertained, then watch sports. Sports is always more entertaining. And public life, the challenge for journalism is to make things that matter as interesting as they can be. Journalism is in another of its chronic economic upheavals and crises. I say chronic because at almost any given time in the history of the media, it's been going through some transformation. There's never been a time in history where news as we think of it, news about your civic life, news about foreign affairs, news about the government, when that's been a profitable business. It always had to be attached to something else as a subsidy. And when I was a kid for the Los Angeles Times, it was 500 pages thick with movie ads and all this stuff, and that supported the real news. So the host body of the thick newspaper is being killed off, and journalism is finding a new body now. I think it is both, journalism is better and worse now than it's ever been. The high end, you can inform yourself now in a way that nobody in previous human history could. If there's a coup someplace tomorrow, you can see video on site, you can have professors writing op-eds, you know, on their blogs, etc. But the distractibility of everything is low too. So I think it's like everything else in a free society. It's a mixture of goods and bads. And so people in our business, the Atlantic is the oldest magazine in the United States. It's now a successful business. It's a combination of our print magazine, our website, and our events business. And we found that our brand that is working is essentially high-end journalism, trying to sell better stuff. And so I think that just as democratic politics is always chaotic, American education is always chaotic, journalism is a big mess too. And the main thing you can do for your individual information is finding good information sources. And the main thing you can do for the business is subscribing to publications that you think are good and that you want to survive. I'm just saying. So with that, I may, this may be our last question. Yes, sir.
Edward Kent, I'm a physician, and I teach anatomy and physiology now at the college level. I'd like to say, first of all, thank you to everyone here for taking care of us civilians. I miss Vietnam by a little bit. But Vietnam was on the war on the TV every night for us. We saw what the soldiers were doing. We don't see that with this war, so your profession has some doing in that as well for not bringing to us what Vietnam or what the Vietnamese call the American War.
Yeah.
On the topic of Congress, how many people write letters? As part of our national organization, I have been in the congressional offices as a quote-unquote physician, lobbyist, Medicare, things like that. And the statistics that they had given us, those that actually write Congress as Americans is 0.3 to 0.7%, which means only 0.5% of Americans have ever written a letter or contacted their congressional leaders. So a lot of people may bitch about government, but very few are willing to convey their opinions. And to everyone here, what they told us is the best way to communicate with Congress is to take a letter, type it up, put it in the fax machine, and send it. You then got in through the front door. You didn't have to go through the mail system, through anthrax and everything.
Yeah. yes, those are all good points. On the letters to public officials, here's a very important thing to bear in mind about that. I'm speaking from the time, both the time in the White House and also knowing a number of politicians since then. If some group you're a member of says, oh, here's a form letter you can send, whatever it is, don't even bother sending that. You know, the politician can tell in 1 second. It's the same letter they're getting from 10,000 other people. And so they register it sort of, but an actual letter where you're saying things in your own words, that has tremendous impact precisely because it's so rare. You know, people think you've actually taken the trouble. It is true, bizarrely, that because of that anthrax scare, you can't mail things to Congress anymore. So the only place for the fax machine any longer makes any sense is in our democratic system of government. So you're right, fax letters to your Congress. So I will say sincerely, I am honored by your attention and your coming here, and I'm genuinely stimulated by all the things you said. And I will think about these and see how in our journalistic institution we can play our part in trying to knit things back together. So thank you all very much.
Hey, so seeing how I wanted to perhaps frame a thank you tonight, I was reflecting upon drivers of a successful democracy, and I'd say that two key drivers of that democracy are probably mechanisms for illuminating diverse perspectives, and then creating a culture or sustaining a culture of thoughtful reflection and discussion. And so I think it's appropriate that on behalf of the staff, the faculty, and then the students at the Naval War College to thank you for your efforts in supporting both of those drivers. over the course of your career, and then especially most recently, the recent article, and then your discussion and your engagement with us tonight. I think you've done both, given us new perspectives to think about, and you'll be stimulating some thoughtful discussion on the campus in the days and the weeks to come. So, sir, thanks very much for spending time with us tonight.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Thank you all.